Good day, everyone, and welcome. This is Ray Ford with FDA Center for Drug Evaluation and Research Small Business and Industry Assistance Program, also known as CDER SBIA. Thank you for joining us today for our presentation on Overview of Proposed 21 CFR 205, National Standards for the Licensure of Wholesale Drug Distributors and Third-Party Logistics Providers. FDA will provide an overview of the proposed rule regarding licensure processes and standards for third-party logistics providers and wholesale distributors of prescription drugs. In issuing this rule, FDA is proposing to replace the current regulations in 21 CFR Part 205 with this new Part 205 that will implement the licensure requirements of the Drug Supply Chain Security Act and govern licensure of third-party logistics provider and wholesale distributors. When finalized, this rule will be replacing existing 21 CFR Part 205 in its entirety. Our speakers today include, first, Aaron Weisbach, Senior Regulatory Advisor, Division of Supply Chain Integrity, Office of Drug Security Integrity Response, Office of Compliance, CDER FDA. Aaron Weisbach is a Senior Regulatory Advisor in the Division of Supply Chain Integrity within CDER's Office of Drug Security, Integrity, and Response, where he focuses on policy and compliance issues related to prescription drugs and implementation of the Drug Supply Chain Security Act. Following Mr. Weisbach, we welcome Elizabeth Pipinski, Regulatory Counsel, Supply Chain Security Branch, Division of Supply Chain Integrity, Office of Drug Security, Integrity, and Response. Elizabeth Pipinski is a regulatory counsel in the Office of Drug Security, Integrity, and Response within CDER's Office of Compliance. Prior to joining ODSIR, she served as a health science policy analyst in CDER's Office of Prescription Drug Promotion, where she primarily focused on guidance and policy development. Our final speaker will be Sarah Kim Keller, Regulatory Counsel, Supply Chain Security Branch, Division of Supply Chain Integrity, Office of Drug Security, Integrity, and Response, Office of Compliance, CDER FDA. Sarah Keller is a Regulatory Counsel and Division of Supply Chain Integrity within the Office of Drug Security, Integrity, and Response. Prior to joining ODSIR, she worked in the Office of Compliance and Enforcement in the FDA's Center for Tobacco Products. Please join me in welcoming our first presenter, Mr. Weisbach.
All right. Thank you, Ray, for that introduction. We'll get right into our agenda for the presentation. So first, we're going to begin with a brief overview of the Drug Supply Chain Security Act, which is commonly referred to and will be referred to as DSCSA. We'll then introduce some important terms and definitions. We'll review how to leave comments on the proposed rule for FDA, and we'll discuss the key requirements of the proposed rule with a focus on the licensure processes and standards for third-party logistics providers and for wholesale distributors. We will not be covering every provision in the proposed rule, and additionally, some of the content provided is summarized. So please consult the text of the proposed regulation to ensure that you obtain complete information regarding each section. Please review the full text of the rule for complete details. Today's goal is to provide an overview of the content and some of the key requirements for wholesale distributors and 3PLs. Updates and links to FDA documents or notices summarized in this presentation can be found on the DSCSA webpage on FDA's website. We'll begin with a brief overview and an introduction of some important definitions, beginning with the Drug Supply Chain Security Act, or DSCSA. The DSCSA was enacted on November 27, 2013, and it establishes the requirement for national licensure standards for wholesale drug distributors and third-party logistics providers, also known as 3PLs. The DSCSA further outlines steps to implement enhanced drug distribution security requirements to identify and trace certain prescription drugs as they are distributed in the United States. The law enhances the ability to help protect consumers from exposure to drugs that may be counterfeit, stolen, contaminated, or otherwise harmful. And the DSCSA improves detection and removal of potentially dangerous drugs from the drug supply chain. DSCSA outlines requirements for specific trading partners in the pharmaceutical distribution supply chain that are involved in the manufacture, distribution, and dispensing of prescription drugs. And those trading partners include manufacturers, repackagers, wholesale drug distributors, you might hear that referred to as WDDs, dispensers, which are primarily pharmacies, and third-party logistics providers, which you may hear referred to as 3PLs. These regulations primarily affect WDDs and 3PLs, and the proposed rule, which we'll be discussing today, addresses the licensure processes and standards for WDDs and 3PLs. Now I'm going to walk through just a few key definitions related to the proposed rule. The FD&C Act, as amended by the DSCSA, defines a wholesale distributor as a person other than a manufacturer, a manufacturer's co-licensed partner, a third-party logistics provider or repackager who is engaged in wholesale distribution. So we must define wholesale distribution. Wholesale distribution, as defined in Section 503(e)(4) of the FD&C Act as amended by DSCSA, means distribution of a drug subject to subsection B, meaning a prescription drug, to a person other than a consumer or patient, or receipt of a prescription drug by a person other than a consumer or patient. I want to note that Section 503(e)(4) contains several exceptions from this general definition of wholesale distribution that we're not covering on this slide, and we encourage you to review those provisions in Section 503(e)(4). Regarding the scope of such drugs covered, under Section 201G of the FD&C Act, a drug includes a bulk drug substance. And under current FDA regulations, the term bulk drug substance means any substance that, as used here, is represented for use in a prescription drug, and that when used in the manufacturing, processing, or packaging of a prescription drug, becomes an active ingredient or a finished dosage form of the prescription drug. FDA believes that the distribution of bulk drug substances must have the same safeguards and provisions as the distribution of finished drug products. The same safeguards that prevent diversion and theft and secure the pharmaceutical distribution supply chain generally must include the transfer of bulk drug substances, as they're subject to the same concerns as the distribution of prescription drugs in finished dosage form. Accordingly, entities engaged in the wholesale distribution of bulk drug substances are subject to the same requirements under the proposed rule as those distributing finished prescription drugs. The FD&C Act, as amended by DSCSA, defines a third-party logistics provider, a 3PL, as an entity that provides or coordinates warehousing or other logistics services of a product in interstate commerce on behalf of a manufacturer, wholesale distributor, or dispenser of a product, but does not take ownership of the product, nor have responsibility to direct the sale or disposition of the product. As the term other logistics services in the definition of 3PL is not defined in the DSCSA, Section 205.3(i) of the proposed rule describes those activities and is displayed on the slide. Please note that other logistics services also means services undertaken with respect to a product for a repackager acting on behalf of a manufacturer, wholesale distributor, or dispenser. We're talking about the definition of product with respect to 3PLs. Proposed Section 205.3(k) defines product as a prescription drug in a finished dosage form for administration to a patient without substantial further manufacturing. So regarding product with respect to 3PLs in the proposed rule defines product under Section 205.3(k) broadly and more inclusively than how product is defined for the purposes of the product tracing requirements under Section 582 of the FD&C Act. In other words, the proposed rule definition for product does not include the exceptions listed in the definition in Section 581.13 of the Act. So that's an important distinction to make. Next, we're going to talk a little bit about the DSCSA authority for the regulations. So in passing the DSCSA, Congress recognized the need for national standards for the storage, handling, and transport of prescription drugs, and directed FDA in sections 583A and 584D of the FD&C Act to establish such standards by regulation for WDDs and 3PLs, respectively. This slide outlines FDA's authority under which those regulations are being promulgated. The FD&C Act, as amended by DSCSA, requires that FDA establish by regulation the standards for licensing of wholesale distributors under Section 503E1 of the Act. As provided by Section 503E1, subject to Section 583, no wholesale distributor may engage in wholesale distribution of a drug unless they are licensed by the state from which the drug is distributed, or if the state has not established a licensure framework, is licensed by FDA. Additionally, if the drug is distributed interstate and the state into which the drug is being distributed requires a license to ship into that state, the wholesale distributor must be licensed by that state. All state and federal licenses described in Section 503E1 must meet the standards established by FDA through this rulemaking once effective. The FD&C Act, as amended by DSCSA, also requires that FDA issue regulations regarding the standards for licensing 3PLs under Section 584A of the Act. Similar to WDDs, in accordance with the FDA, with FDA regulations once effective, a 3PL must be licensed by the state from which they conduct 3PL activities, or by FDA if the state does not have a licensure program for 3PLs. Also similar to WDDs, as I just mentioned, a 3PL must have a license to distribute into a different state if that state requires such a license to distribute into the state. A key distinction for 3PLs is that if a 3PL is licensed by FDA and ships interstate, it's not required to have a license from any state into which the 3PL ships. When this regulation is effective, every United States wholesale drug distributor and 3PL facility will be held to these standards and the statute's licensure requirements. Where a state does not have a licensing program in accordance with the regulation, FDA will be the licensing authority. As mentioned earlier, when finalized, this rule will replace the existing regulations in the Code of Federal Regulation at Title 21 CFR Part 205. I'm going to talk now about the need for this regulation, why it's important. The need for this regulation stems from several factors, some of which have resulted from illegitimate product in the supply chain due to diversion schemes and criminal activity. But first, when finalized and effective, this rule will provide much needed certainty and clarity for WDDs and 3PLs seeking licensure. Currently, requirements for wholesale distributors vary significantly across state lines, and many wholesale distributors and 3PLs have facilities in multiple states. Specifically, state requirements and standards for licensure currently vary on topics such as the length of time for which records must be maintained, qualifications for facility managers and designated representatives, facility requirements, licensure duration, renewal procedures, exemptions from the definition of wholesale distribution, and inspection and approval requirements by certain specific organizations in order to receive licensure in certain states. And you're going to hear more about these types of requirements and standards throughout the entire presentation. Since the passage of DSCSA, states have implemented disparate policies with respect to licensure of 3PLs. For example, some states repealed or eliminated 3PL as a licensure category. Others are waiting for FDA to publish its regulations, which we now have in draft, before determining how to proceed. Some states are licensing 3PLs under some other form of licensure, and some states don't regulate 3PLs at all. So in addition to the goals of the harmonization of state requirements, theft and diversion of prescription drugs continue to be major issues, contributing to drug shortages and creating significant financial losses, the effects of which cascade throughout the supply chain to consumers. FDA has observed that these instances involving thefts and diversion often involve products distributed by unlicensed wholesale distributors. FDA standards, oversight, and regulation including to implement the requirements of DSCSA, will lessen and hopefully eliminate product aversion and other threats to the legitimate supply chain. To create the standards proposed in the regulation, FDA conducted a comprehensive review of existing state standards for licensure, including storing, handling, and holding of prescription drugs, as well as other nationally recognized standards and model rules for wholesale distribution and logistics. The agency believes that the proposed standards align with existing practices and will help ensure that 3PL and wholesale distribution activities are undertaken in a manner that minimizes diversion and threats to the regulated supply chain. Next, we're going to talk about the proposed effective dates for the national standards. DSCSA states that the national licensing standards for 3PLs take effect 1 year after the date such final regulation is published, and that the national licensing standards for wholesale distributors established by regulation take effect 2 years after the date such final regulation is published. And you can see this reflected in the DSCSA effective dates column on the slide. FDA recognizes that 1 year may be insufficient time for states to implement 3PL licensure programs should they decide to implement such programs, and for 3PLs to apply for licensure under those programs. So for this reason, FDA is proposing not to enforce requirements with respect to the national standards for licensure of 3PLs until 2 years after the regulation is finalized, in order to provide states with the opportunity to establish or modify their licensure programs in accordance with the new standards and allow time for 3PLs to apply and obtain a new license. Next, an overview of preemption as it relates to the national standards for licensure. In this proposed rule, we explain FDA's interpretation of Section 585(b)(1) of the FD&C Act as preempting states and localities from establishing or continuing requirements for 3PL or WDD licensure that are different from the standards and requirements applicable under the regulations promulgated under Sections 584 and amended 503E of the FD&C Act. In other words, states and local governments may not establish or continue licensure requirements for 3PLs or WDDs unless those state requirements are the same as federal requirements. Different requirements are preempted. Draft guidance issued in October 2014 entitled The Effect of Section 585 on the FD&C Act on Drug Product Tracing and Wholesale Distributor and Third-Party Logistics Provider Licensing Standards and Requirements, Questions and Answers, proposed a different preemption interpretation under which states and localities could impose requirements on 3PL and WDD licensure that were different from federal requirements, so long as those requirements did not fall below the federal standards. FDA has reconsidered its earlier proposed interpretation and determined that our current interpretation, that the federal requirements will establish both a floor and a ceiling, is more consistent with the language of the statute, congressional purpose, and policy considerations. Accordingly, on the date of the publication of the proposed rule, FDA withdrew that portion of the October 2014 draft guidance addressing preemption with respect to WDD and 3PL licensure. State and local licensure requirements, which are inconsistent with federal requirements, as reflected in this regulation, will be preempted only once this regulation, when finalized, takes effect. Until such time, current state and local licensing of WDDs and 3PLs may continue. And for a complete discussion of this concept, please see the effective date of preemption section of the proposed rule. All right, next we're going to transition to provide a brief overview of how to submit comments on the proposed regulations. We do encourage you to leave a comment on the proposed rule so we can consider your feedback as we move towards finalization and implementation of the national standards. So to submit your comment, visit this web address on the page, and feel free to pause here and make a note of this site. At this location, you will find the docket for the proposed rule on regulations.gov. Once there, you'll click the blue comment button, which is as indicated on the slide. Additionally, you'll note that the comments page provides the user with a countdown of how many days are left in the comment period. Please note that the comment period for this proposed rule closes on June 6th, 2022 at 11:59 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, so you'll want to get your comments in before then. Once you click the comments page, you will be able to type your comment in the space provided. You can also select a comment category from the drop-down menu to indicate what your comment is about. If you don't want to type your comments in and you have your comments prepared in a separate document, you can attach your file to the comments page. Once you've either typed in your comments or you've attached your file, please remember to include your email address. Next, you'll want to indicate whether you're commenting as an individual, on behalf of an organization, or if you wish to submit your comment anonymously. Once you've completed entering the required information and inserted your comments, you'll check the acknowledgement box and click Submit Comment. If you've never commented on a document like this before, I think you'll find it to be quite easy. Alternatively, you can find the proposed rule and the comment page through the Federal Register website. You can visit this URL on the slide and search for the National Standards for the Licensure of Wholesale Drug Distributors and Third-Party Logistics Providers. And please feel free to pause this and go ahead and do that. Once you've found the proposed rule, click on Submit a Formal Comment. The link to the proposed rule is also available on FDA's DSCSA webpage, which is linked on the slide as well. All right, now that we've completed an overview and shown you how to submit a comment on the proposed rule, we'll now begin our discussion of the contents of the proposed rule. And with that, I'll hand it over to Elizabeth Popinski to kick us off.
Thanks, Aaron. FDA is proposing in revised Part 205 to establish national standards for licensing by state and federal licensing authorities that would apply to 3PL facilities in any state, and national standards for licensing that would apply to wholesale distributors of prescription drugs in any state. The scope, purpose, and definitions for the proposed rule can be found in proposed sections 205.1, 205.2, and 205.3, respectively. The purpose of this part is to establish standards, terms, and conditions for the licensing of 3PLs and prescription drug wholesale distributors by state or federal licensing authority, including a process for the revocation, reissuance, and renewal of such licenses. This part also establishes the process and standards the FDA will use to approve third-party organizations to evaluate the qualifications of 3PLs for licensure and conduct inspections of wholesale distributor facilities. While included in the proposed rule, the process for approving third-party organizations under the proposed rule is not the focus of this webinar. The definitions and interpretations of terms contained in Section 581 of the FD&C Act apply to those terms when used in proposed Part 205. Proposed Section 205.3 defines additional terms, such as facility, key personnel, and other logistics providers, to help clarify the requirements of the proposed rule. After providing the definitions of important relevant terms, the proposed rule begins a discussion of 3PL processes and standards. Proposed Section 205.4 covers 3PL licensure requirements. Section 584 of the FD&C Act requires that a 3PL be licensed in order to conduct activities in any state. Accordingly, proposed Section 205.4 provides that a 3PL facility may not conduct 3PL activities unless it is licensed by the state from which it conducts 3PL activities. So for example, if a 3PL owns or leases a facility serving as a warehouse for products, the state in which the facility is located will be considered the state from which the 3PL conducts activities and will be the state from which the 3PL must obtain a license for that facility. If the state has not established a licensure program in accordance with the regulation, the 3PL must be licensed by FDA. Additionally, if the product is distributed in interstate commerce, the 3PL must also be licensed by the state into which the product is distributed if that state requires such license. However, 3PLs licensed by FDA are not required to obtain a license from the state into which the product is distributed. To ensure that a facility and those responsible for its operations meet the licensing standards, FDA also proposes to require that 3PL licenses be facility and owner specific and not transferable to another establishment or owner. 3PL licenses must be held at the licensed facility and must be made available to state, federal, or other licensing authorities upon request. Proposed Section 205.5 outlines the general requirements that must be met for a state or federal licensing authority to issue an initial license to a 3PL facility or a renewal of any such license. Under Proposed Section 205.5, the person submitting the application must be at least 18 years old and submit all required information, including an affidavit stating that the applicant's ownership or management of or employment by the entity would not preclude the entity from receiving or maintaining a license under proposed section 205.11F. The applicant must also pay any applicable licensing fees to be issued a license. Proposed section 205.5B outlines the information required from each 3PL facility as part of the initial application for licensure and any renewals of such license. This information is summarized on the slide. FDA believes that this information is necessary for the licensing authority to assess whether the 3PL is in good standing and has the infrastructure and capabilities to fulfill its duties and obligations under the national standards for 3PL licensure. With respect to the disclosure of certain felonies, the application for licensure must include whether a 3PL facility manager or designated representative has ever been convicted of a felony relating to prescription drug distribution, including a conviction under Section 301I or K of the FD&C Act, or 18 U.S.C. 1365 relating to product tampering. FDA believes that this information is crucial to protect the integrity of the prescription drug supply chain by ensuring that those responsible for the daily operations of a 3PL facility do not have a history of violating the FD&C Act. For licensure renewals, the 3PL is also required to certify that the 3PL facility has continually met the requirements of proposed Section 205.5 and inform the licensing authority of certain changes to information if such changes have not already been submitted to the licensing authority. Proposed Section 205.6 outlines the process for applying for 3PL licensure with FDA in the instance that the state does not establish a licensure program. While proposed Section 205.6 is only applicable to 3PLs obtaining a license from FDA, FDA suggests that states implement similar procedures. The FDA licensure process begins when a 3PL seeking licensure of a facility submits an application to FDA for review and consideration. The application must be submitted electronically. Where FDA has approved one or more organizations to review a 3PL's qualifications for licensure as permitted by the DSCSA, the 3PL should indicate which authorized organization, or AO, the 3PL prefers to conduct its licensure review. The licensure review consists of a review of all documents submitted in support of the application and an inspection of the facility. Note the FDA generally intends to review a 3PL's qualifications for licensure only if the review cannot be completed by an FDA-approved AO. The application must be signed by the applicant, applicant's agent, or other authorized official, and all fees must be paid. The application must include the information specified in Section 205.5, along with supporting documentation that demonstrates the applicant's storage practices are sufficient to ensure the continued safety, identity, strength, quality, and purity of the products in the facility. So as not to delay the licensure process, when reviewing an application, FDA intends to work with 3PLs to correct minor errors made on the application and communicate with the 3PL about additional information the agency may need. The FDA will determine whether the applicable requirements are met. If an AO has conducted the licensure review, the responsibility for determining whether the applicable requirements are met will remain with FDA. When FDA determines that a 3PL facility meets the applicable requirements and that none of the disqualifying factors listed in proposed section 205.9A1 are present, FDA will send the applicant an approval letter and a licensing certificate effective on the date it is issued. The license will remain valid until it expires unless it is suspended or revoked. For the licensing authority to effectively carry out its responsibilities, a 3PL must keep its license information current and report any changes in information, including those changes that may significantly affect operations, such as changes in location or ownership, to the licensing authority. Presently, the reporting requirements for these types of changes vary by state. FDA is proposing in Section 205.7 that changes to certain information, including, for example, any change to information submitted as part of an application for licensure, be submitted electronically to the licensing authority within 30 calendar days of the change. The agency is also proposing that changes in the location or ownership of a 3PL facility will require a new license. Specifically, for a change in location at which 3PL activities are conducted, a new inspection of the facility and license is required before commencing 3PL activities at the location. The 3PL must submit an application for the new license no later than 90 calendar days prior to beginning operations at the new location. For changes to the 3PL's ownership, a new license will be required. A new inspection of the facility may be required at the discretion of the licensing authority. The application for licensure upon an ownership change must be submitted no later than 30 calendar days prior to the 3PL beginning operations under the new ownership. Proposed Section 205.8 implements the DSCSA requirement that the national standards for 3PLs provide that a 3PL license expires 3 years after the date of issuance, with the option of renewal for additional 3-year periods. Under the proposed rule, all 3PL licenses, whether newly issued or renewed by the licensing authority, expire 3 years from the date of issuance or renewal. FDA also proposes that 3PLs may not submit renewal applications more than 90 days prior to the license's date of expiration to ensure that licenses are renewed based on current information. While we do not anticipate lengthy administrative delays by the licensing authority, if a 3PL files an application for a license renewal within the appropriate timeframe and there is an administrative delay reviewing that license application that causes the 3PL license to lapse, the 3PL's license will be considered valid during the period of the administrative delay. Proposed Section 205.9 outlines the standards and processes for 3PL license denials, suspensions, reinstatement, revocation, and voluntary termination. Proposed Section 205.9A1 describes 9 circumstances under which the licensing authority would be required to deny a 3PL's request for licensure or licensure renewal, and these circumstances are summarized on the slide. They include, for example, inadequate facilities and controls to facilitate safe operations, failure to meet or comply with requirements for good storage practices, and failure to provide adequate opportunity for inspections of the facility, controls, or applicable records. FDA believes that this list will help 3PLs focus on good storage practices outlined by FDA that are necessary to protect the integrity of the products in this pharmaceutical distribution supply chain. To avoid denials or delays of their applications, 3PLs should address possible reasons for denial of a license outlined in proposed Section 205.9A1 when they file for licensure. Under proposed section 205.9 B and C, the suspension of a 3PL's license may be initiated by the licensing authority upon a reasonable belief that the licensee has failed to comply with any of the standards for receiving and maintaining licensure. The proposed standards for suspending a 3PL license are based on the risk posed to the public health by such noncompliance. Under most circumstances, we anticipate that a 3PL would have the opportunity for a hearing before licensure suspension. However, where the nature of the noncompliance would reasonably be expected to cause an imminent threat to public health, the agency may suspend a license immediately while giving the 3PL an opportunity to request a hearing. FDA believes that immediate suspension of a 3PL license is crucial where continued operation of the 3PL presents such an imminent threat to public health. Under proposed section 205.9D, a 3PL's suspended license may be reinstated if the 3PL can demonstrate to the licensing authority that it is in compliance with regulation requirements. The standards for revoking a 3PL license are set forth in proposed section 205.9E. The licensing authority will revoke a license if it finds that a 3PL whose license has been suspended is unable or refuses to comply with the licensing requirements. In addition to describing the circumstances under which a license may be denied, suspended, or revoked, proposed section 205.9 outlines the process for these actions. In general, the procedures for the denial of an application for licensure and for the suspension or revocation of a license involve written notice by the licensing authority, an opportunity for the 3PL to respond, and the opportunity for a 3PL to request a hearing. But as I previously mentioned, proposed section 205.9C allows for license suspension immediately if the 3PL's noncompliance poses an imminent threat to public health. So for example, if a 3PL is shipping illegitimate product and once made aware, fails to take corrective actions to protect the public health from the threat of these products, the 3PL's license could be suspended immediately while giving the 3PL an opportunity to request a hearing after the suspension. Under the proposed rule, the procedures in 21 CFR parts 10 through 16 apply with respect to hearings and appeals of denied, suspended, or revoked 3PL licenses. FDA believes that this proposed approach is consistent with current practice and suggests that states develop comparable processes. The proposed rule also sets forth conditions for licensure non-renewals and voluntary terminations. For non-renewals, where a 3PL fails to submit an application for renewal by the date of the license's expiration, the license will be considered expired, and the 3PL will need to submit an application for new licensure. For voluntary terminations, a 3PL requesting that the licensing authority terminate its license must include in its request a notice of the 3PL's intent to discontinue its activities and a waiver of an opportunity for a hearing. The 3PL will be required to apply for a new license should it decide to resume 3PL activities. Now we'll move on to discuss good storage practices required for 3PL facilities as outlined in Section 205.10. Proposed Section 205.10 outlines 3PL storage practice requirements. These include the requirements that a facility is not a personal residence, that it is of a suitable size, construction, and configuration to ensure proper storage and distribution, as well as cleaning, maintenance, and proper operation, that the facility is maintained in a clean and orderly condition, that the facility has sufficient lighting, ventilation, temperature, sanitation, humidity, space, equipment, and secure conditions, and that the facility has defined designated areas that separate saleable products from products that are unfit for distribution. The proposed rule also requires adequate security, which means the facility is secure from unauthorized entry, that access from the outside is limited, well-controlled, and documented, that the outside perimeter of the premises is well-lit, the facility is equipped with an alarm to detect and notify entry after hours, and that the facility's security system protects against theft and diversion of products. With respect to the facility's equipment, the facility's equipment must be calibrated and validated at regular intervals. The facility must have appropriate temperature and humidity recording equipment or logs to document proper storage, and monitoring equipment must provide timely alert of any deviations from intended storage conditions in the facility. Proposed Section 205.11 outlines the personnel requirements for good storage practices. Ensuring that that 3PL personnel are appropriately qualified is integral to establishing good storage practices. Therefore, FDA proposes requiring that 3PLs maintain and make available to the licensing authority certain information about their facility's managers and designated representatives. More specifically, 3PLs are required to maintain a list of officers, directors, facility managers, and designated representatives, a description of their duties, and a summary of their qualifications. Furthermore, a facility manager or a designated representative must have the education, background, training, and experience that are necessary to perform their assigned functions. FDA is proposing to require that a facility manager or designated representative serve in either capacity for only one facility at a time. That facility manager or designated representative must be actively involved in and responsible for managing the daily operations of the 3PL facility to ensure that they remain aware of any non-compliance issues that may arise. FDA believes that the facility manager or designated representative must be accountable for all operations of a 3PL facility, including those duties delegated to other personnel. To ensure the qualified facility manager or designated representative can fulfill the obligations to manage and carry out daily operations, FDA proposes to require that a 3PL provide them with the adequate authority and the necessary resources. FDA believes that establishing these requirements will help ensure that the products handled by a 3PL are properly safeguarded to protect the pharmaceutical supply chain and the public health. Proposed regulations prohibit a 3PL from obtaining or maintaining licensure if the 3PL employs a facility manager or designated representative who has been convicted of any felony Section 301I or K of the FD&C Act, or convicted of any violation of 18 U.S.C. 1365 related to product tampering. Under the proposed rule, any facility manager or designated representative will be subject to criminal background checks. The result of these background checks must demonstrate no history of criminal convictions as just described. Additionally, under the proposed rule, licensure of a 3PL may be denied if its storage practices are insufficient to maintain adequate security because a facility manager or designated representative omitted material information or furnished false or fraudulent information in connection with the distribution of prescription drugs or delayed or otherwise impeded an inspection by a licensing authority. Such instances of storage practice noncompliance are not an absolute bar to licensure, but they are factors that may be considered by the licensing authorities when reviewing an application for licensure to determine whether the 3PL has storage practices sufficient to maintain adequate security over the facility. Proposed Section 205.12 lays out requirements for written policies and procedures to the extent that these procedures are relevant to the scope of the 3PL's activities. The required written policies and procedures must delineate responsibilities of the 3PL and describe a system by which the 3PL will monitor all of its processes. The proposed 3PL requirements include that the written policies and procedures must be made available to the licensing authority upon request, and the licensing authority will be permitted to have access and copy records of the 3PL to ensure that the 3PL facility is following its written policies and procedures. In particular, 3PLs must establish, maintain, and follow written policies and procedures related to personnel, receipt, security, storage, inventory, shipments, and distribution, recall products, preparing for foreseeable crises, products that are unfit for distribution, suspect products, and illegitimate products. The maintenance, availability, and accuracy of records and written policies and procedures is critical so that upon inspection of these records, 3PLs can demonstrate that they are acting in compliance with applicable requirements and to ensure their records can be relied on to identify any potential risk to the public health. Proposed Section 205.13 proposes standards for such records. The proposed rule outlines in Section 205.13 that records must be readily retrievable and made available to licensing authorities. Records must be securely stored and protected from unauthorized access or modifications. Records must contain only alterations signed and dated by the individual who made the alteration, and such alteration must preserve the original information and document the reason for the alteration. And records must accurately reflect the name of the 3PL as it appears on the license, which must match information reported to FDA pursuant to reporting requirements. And please note that under the proposed rule, records can be stored and maintained electronically. Proposed Section 205.13 also requires that 3PLs retain all records for a minimum of 3 years, except for records related to suspect and illegitimate products and destroyed, returned, and recalled products, which each must be retained for a minimum of 6 years. Such record retention is necessary not only to ensure 3PLs are compliant with the FD&C Act, but also to ensure that there is consistency and continuity across the records required. The FD&C Act, as amended by DSCSA, requires that upon the licensing authority's request, 3PLs provide the licensing authority with a list of the trading partners, namely manufacturers, wholesale distributors, and dispensers, for which the 3PL conducts 3PL activities. Proposed Section 205.14 codifies this requirement in regulation and also includes repackagers for which the 3PL provides services when those repackagers are acting on behalf of a manufacturer, wholesale distributor, or dispenser of a product. Proposed Section 205.15 covers the requirements for initial and annual reporting to FDA. Under DSCSA, 3PLs must report certain information to FDA to be considered an authorized trading partner. The annual reporting requirements for 3PLs went into effect on November 27, 2014. Proposed Section 205.15 clarifies the statutorily prescribed annual reporting requirements and proposes the collection of additional information to provide complete and useful information about 3PLs that can be used by FDA, states, and trading partners. Specifically, proposed Section 205.15 requires that a 3PL electronically report to FDA the state by which the 3PL is licensed and the corresponding license number and the name and full address of each facility. FDA is proposing to require that 3PLs use an electronic system provided by FDA to increase efficiency by providing uniformity in the content and format of reports, thereby making the process, therefore making the information easier to process. FDA is also proposing to require that the reported company name be identical to the official company name appearing on the license. In addition, FDA is proposing to require an additional data element, which is the date each state license expires. This information is essential for determining that the licensure status for each 3PL facility is current. A 3PL's initial report must be submitted within 30 calendar days of obtaining its initial license. Annual reporting must be completed each year between January 1st and March 31st. In addition to providing required reporting information upon initial licensure and annually, it's important for other trading partners and FDA to know whether a 3PL has had a license revoked or suspended, or whether a 3PL has had any other significant disciplinary actions taken against them that limits the ability of the facility to conduct drug-related business. As such, 3PLs must report significant disciplinary actions as defined in proposed section 205.3L to FDA. This information must be submitted at licensure with respect to such disciplinary actions occurring during the previous 12 months and for subsequent significant disciplinary actions within 30 calendar days of a final action taken by a state or federal licensing authority. A 3PL will also be expected to report to FDA within 30 calendar days of ceasing warehouse or other logistics services that it is going out of business or voluntarily withdrawing a 3PL license from a state. FDA believes that reporting this information is essential for the information in the public database to be complete, accurate, and useful for FDA, the states, and trading partners. To ensure efficient enforcement of FDA and C Act requirements, and to make public the voluntary information provided by each 3PL facility, FDA proposes adding 3PL licensure to the public database to make information about 3PLs available on FDA's website. Having the license status of 3PLs in one publicly available database will help FDA, trading partners, and other stakeholders determine whether 3PLs are properly licensed and authorized. Proposed Section 205.16 provides for the periodic inspections of 3PL facilities to ensure compliance with the national standards as required by DSCSA. Under Proposed Section 205.16, a physical inspection of a facility owned, rented, or leased by a 3PL for conducting 3PL activities will be required prior to the issuance of an initial license. Routine inspections will occur every 3 years. Where the state is the licensing authority, the state may conduct the inspection or may accept an inspection by a third-party accreditation or inspection service approved by the state licensing authority. If the facility is out of state, the state may conduct the inspection or may accept an inspection by the state in which the facility is located. Where the FDA is the licensing authority, the FDA may conduct the inspection or may accept an inspection by an organization approved by the FDA under proposed section 205.18. To facilitate the licensing authority's ability to complete the inspection, records kept at the inspection site or that can be immediately retrieved electronically must be made readily available during the inspection. For records kept at a central location apart from the inspection site and not electronically retrievable, such records must be made available for inspection within 2 business days of a request by a state or federal official, or sooner if necessitated by the duration of the inspection. We will not be covering approved third-party organizations, or AO, in this presentation. However, FDA will give more information in the future as we implement the rule. Please see proposed sections 205.17, 205.18, and 205.19 for the processes for the use of approved third-party organizations, general qualifications, and the processes and procedures for approval of AOs by FDA. Now, this concludes our discussion of the proposed 3PL requirements. We encourage you to provide your comments on the proposed rule to the public docket, as we described earlier, and following those instructions provided. I will now turn it over to Sarah Keller for an overview of the proposed requirements for wholesale distributors.
Thank you for the introduction. We now move forward with our discussion of wholesale distributor requirements in this proposed rule. To implement Section 503(e)(1) of the FD&C Act, proposed Section 205.20A codifies a requirement that a wholesale drug distributor, or WDD for short, be licensed by the state from which the drug is distributed, or by FDA if the state from which the drug is distributed has not established a licensure requirement in accordance with the standards set forth in the regulation, and by the state into which the drug is distributed if that state requires such a license. This requirement is consistent with how states currently license wholesale distributors. FDA proposes to set the licensure term for wholesale distributors at 2 years. Any license issued or renewed pursuant to this proposed section will expire 2 years after the date on which the license was issued. A wholesale distributor may submit a renewal application up to 90 calendar days before the date of expiration. The agency believes that 2 years aligns with current practices, does not place an undue burden on state or FDA resources, and provides adequate protection to American consumers because it ensures that renewals will be based on current information and operations. The DSCSA requires that wholesale distributors obtain a surety bond to be licensed and engage in wholesale distribution. FDA is proposing to establish the terms of this requirement in proposed Section 205.21. The surety bond is intended to ensure compliance with DSCSA and that any administrative penalties levied by the licensing authorities are paid. As we are not reviewing the details of this section of the proposed rule, we encourage you to review proposed section 205.21 for the requirements for surety bonds. Proposed section 205.22 outlines the general requirements that must be met for a state or federal licensing authority to issue an initial license to a wholesale distributor or a renewal of any such license. Under proposed section 205.22, the person submitting the application for licensure is the applicant. The applicant must be at least 18 years old and submit all required information, including an affidavit stating that applicant's ownership or management of or employment by the entity would not preclude the entity from receiving or maintaining a license under proposed section 205.25A. The applicant must also pay any applicable licensing fee to be issued a license. As previously mentioned, wholesale distributors are required to obtain a surety bond to be licensed and engaged in wholesale distribution. Proposed section 205.22 requires that the wholesale distributor must furnish a surety bond as described in proposed section 205.21 with this application for licensure. See section 205.21 for more details. Proposed section 205.22C outlines the information that the licensing authority will require as part of a WDD's initial application for licensure and renewal applications. This information is summarized on the slide. FDA believes this information is necessary for the licensing authority to assess whether the WDD is in good standing and has the infrastructure and capabilities to fulfill its duties and obligation under the national standards for WDD licensure. With respect to the disclosure of certain felonies, the application for licensure must include details about whether the WDD has ever been convicted of a felony relating to prescription drug distribution, including a conviction under Section 301I or K of the FD&C Act or 18 U.S.C. 1365 relating to product tampering. Additionally, FDA is proposing to require that the WDD inform FDA if it has received any citations for violating requirements for licensure or received any significant disciplinary actions within the past 7 years that presented a threat of serious adverse health consequences or death to humans. FDA believes this information is necessary to ensure the wholesale distributor can demonstrate that it has not engaged in a pattern of violating the standards for licensure. For licensure renewals, the proposed rule would require the WDD to certify that it continually met the requirements of Subpart C of the regulation and inform the licensing authority of certain changes to information if such changes have not already been submitted to the licensing authority. Under proposed section 25.22E, a wholesale distributor's license must be available upon request. The WDD must maintain its license in a readily retrievable manner and must permit state or federal inspectors or others acting on behalf of the licensing authority to inspect the license. Proposed section 205.23 outlines the process for applying for WDD licensure with FDA in the instance that the state in which it engages in wholesale distribution has not established a licensure program. While proposed section 205.23 is only applicable to WDDs obtaining a license from FDA, FDA recommends that states implement similar procedures to ensure that all WDD licenses issued are consistent with the proposed regulation pursuant to section 503(e)(1)(b) of the FTNC Act. We will now review the proposed process for federal licensure of WDDs. The federal licensure process begins when a WDD seeking licensure for a facility submits an application to FDA for review and consideration. The application must be submitted electronically and include the information set forth in proposed sections 205.21 and 205.22, along with a surety bond and supporting documentation that demonstrates the applicant's ability to comply with requirements intended to ensure the continued safety, identity, strength, quality, and purity of the prescription drugs. Where FDA has approved one or more organizations to conduct inspections of a WDD as permitted by the DSCSA, the WDD should indicate which authorized organization it prefers to conduct its inspection. If no organization has been approved, FDA will conduct the inspection. The application must be signed by the applicant, applicant's agent, or other authorized official, and all fees must be paid. So as not to delay the licensure process, when reviewing an application, FDA intends to work with WDDs to correct minor errors made on the application and communicate with the WDD about additional information the agency may need. The FDA will determine whether applicable requirements are met. If an approved organization has conducted the licensure review, the responsibility for determining whether the applicable requirements are met will remain with the FDA. Issuance of a license is covered under proposed section 205.23D. When FDA determines that the WDD meets the applicable requirements under sections 503(e)(1) and 583 of the FD&C Act, and none of the prohibited factors listed in proposed section 205.30A are present, FDA will send the applicant an approval letter and a licensing certificate effective on the date that it is issued. The license will remain valid until it expires unless it is suspended or revoked. For the licensing authority to effectively carry out its responsibilities, a WDD must keep its license information current and report any changes in information previously submitted to the licensing authority. Currently, the reporting requirements for these types of changes vary by state. Proposed section 205.24 establishes specific timeframes for reporting changes, and FDA believes that standardizing the timeframes will help make reporting business-related changes less burdensome for industry and licensing authorities. Proposed section 205.24 would require the WDD to submit changes to certain information, such as the information submitted with the surety bond or as part of an application for licensure, to the licensing authority within 30 calendar days of the date the change became effective. FDA is also proposing that a change in the location at which wholesale distribution occurs will require an inspection of the new facility prior to commencing wholesale distribution at the location. For a change to the person engaged in wholesale distribution, a new license will be required prior to beginning operations. the application for a new license must be submitted no later than 30 calendar days prior to the change in ownership. A new inspection of the WDD will be performed at a reasonable time. Proposed Section 205.25 covers the standards for the qualifications of wholesale distributors' key personnel, such as prohibited conduct, basic standards for key personnel working within a wholesale distribution facility, and grounds for denying a licensure application. As described in proposed Section 205.3G, FDA considers key personnel to include any individual who has responsibility for managing the operations of the wholesale distributor, including any principal, owner, director, officer of the wholesale distributor, designated representatives, and other individuals who are authorized to enter areas where prescription drugs are held and are likely to handle prescription drugs as part of their responsibilities. Proposed Section 205.25 covers prohibited persons and qualifications for key personnel. Under this proposed section, a WDD is prohibited from obtaining or maintaining licensure if the WDD has been convicted of a felony relating to prescription drug distribution, including a conviction under Section 301I or K of the FD&C Act, or 18 U.S.C. 1365 relating to product tampering, or if the WDD has been cited for certain repeated violations related to the FD&C Act that presents threat of serious adverse health consequences or death to humans. Under proposed Section 205.25, key personnel working within a wholesale distribution facility must have the appropriate education, background training, and experience necessary to carry out their assigned functions within the operation. No one within the facility should carry out responsibilities of key personnel without the proper training and experience. Also under proposed Section 205.25C, licensure may be denied if a wholesale distributor or any of their key personnel delayed or impeded inspection, omitted material information of furnished, false, or fraudulent information in an application, or is subject to licensure suspension or revocation for currently or previously held license for manufacture of distribution or distribution of any drugs. Proposed Section 205.25D states that a WDD must maintain a list of officers, directors, facility managers, designated representatives, and other key personnel in charge of wholesale distribution, including storage and handling, and include a description of their duties and a summary of their qualification. Proposed Section 205.25E describes how a WDD must also establish and implement written policies and procedure designed to ensure that their key personnel meet the necessary qualifications. These policies and procedures must identify the personnel at the WDD's facility who are responsible for implementing and maintaining facility personnel requirements, complying with all licensure reporting requirements, and ensuring key personnel receive initial and regular training. Proposed Section 205.25F limits a facility manager or designated representative to hold that position at one facility at a time. This is to ensure that the facility manager or designated representative is actively engaged in managing the daily operations of the facility and that they remain aware of any non-compliance issues that may arise. Section 583B4 of the FD&C Act, as added by DSCSA, requires fingerprinting and background checks of facility managers and designated representative of wholesale distributors. The background check, when completed, must demonstrate that the facility manager or representative has no history of criminal convictions pursuant to proposed section 205.25A and outlined in slide number 84. Proposed section 205.26 establishes basic standards for the storage and handling of prescription drugs by wholesale distributors, including facility requirements. Although the FD&C Act permits an entity to be more than one type of trading partner, so long as it complies with all applicable DSCSA requirements, FDA believes that the processes and functions of each type of entity need to be kept separate for the licensing authority to ensure the entity is complying with all applicable requirements. Therefore, under proposed section 205.26A, any wholesale distributor's facility that is also licensed or registered as another trading partner, such as a 3PL, and operating from the same address must have separate systems and processes in place for their separate functions. Proposed section 205.26B1 describes how the facility must be of a suitable size, configuration, and design to ensure proper storage, maintenance, and cleanliness. The facility must also be equipped with clearly defined areas that separate drugs that are unfit for distribution from those that are saleable to avoid potential mistakes when distributing the prescription drugs. Under proposed section 205.26B2, facilities must be sufficiently secure to protect the prescription drugs in the supply chain from possible theft or diversion. Facilities must protect against unauthorized entry and ensure that the premises are well lit and not vulnerable to intrusion. Entry and access to areas where prescription drugs are held within the facility must be limited to those who have the appropriate experience and training needed to conduct wholesale distribution. Proposed section 205.26B3 outlines how a WDD has the responsibility of ensuring that prescription drugs are stored under proper conditions to maintain the safety and effectiveness of the drugs it distributes. A facility must have equipment that ensures prescription drugs are properly stored, such as cold storage, refrigerators, temperature and humidity devices, and air handling units. Also, equipment must be maintained in good repair and must be suitable for distribution of prescription drugs. Facility assessments must be regularly conducted and documented. Accordingly, a WDD's facility must maintain appropriate equipment in good working order to ensure that prescription drugs are properly stored in the facility. To this end, FDA is proposing that WDDs establish written procedures to ensure that equipment is installed, maintained, and repaired by qualified individuals following written procedures. Equipment should be calibrated and validated at regular intervals. We further propose that WDDs use manual, electromechanical, or electronic temperature and humidity recording equipment, or logs, to document proper storage. Monitoring equipment must immediately alert of any deviations from required storage conditions. FDA expects that as a crucial part of the creation of a quality system, wholesale distributors will establish, maintain, and follow written policies and procedures regarding the safeguarding of the prescription drugs within their control. Proposed section 205.26C outlines several requirements for maintaining written policies and procedures to ensure that the requirements are carried out properly and consistently. The requirements listed on this slide include the requirement to do business with other authorized trading partners, the requirement to properly maintain equipment in good working order, and the requirement to inspect shipping containers for suspect or illegitimate products, among others. Please refer to proposed section 205.26C for a complete list. Wholesale distributors are not limited to establishing written policies and procedures for the stated functions in proposed Section 205.26C. A wholesale distributor may wish to establish written policies and procedures pertaining to other aspects of wholesale distribution and staffing of their facilities. The purpose of requiring written policies and procedures is to assist staff and management at a wholesale distribution facility to determine the processes required to ensure safe storage and distribution of prescription drugs. Wholesale distributors are responsible for contractor compliance. AWDD must ensure that the contractor abides by applicable written policies and procedures. Furthermore, written policies and procedures must clearly describe responsibilities of the WDD and any contractors used to fulfill the WDD's duties. Proper record keeping is essential to the timely identification, recording, and reporting of issues arising within the supply chain. Section 583B2 of the FD&C Act, as added by the DSCSA, requires FDA to create national standards for establishing and maintaining records pertaining to the distribution of prescription drugs. Proposed Section 205.27 covers those standards on records. FDA is proposing in Section 205.27A that these records include documentation pertaining to the storage, handling, security, inventory, shipping of prescription drugs. This will include records related to the sale, purchase, trade, delivery, and receipt, as well as policies, procedures, instructions, contracts, data, inspection reports, and any other documentation related to compliance with this part. The section also includes records related to the distribution of prescription drugs, such as invoices, purchase orders, packing slips, and shipping records. These records could be stored and maintained electronically. These records maintenance requirements will allow for greater confidence in the information preserved at the facility. It will also potentially allow for greater confidence in the information disseminated to other trading partners. All records must be securely stored, and any alteration made to records must be signed and dated while preserving the original information contained in the record. See proposed Section 205.27B. This is intended to ensure that all records related to the distribution of prescription drugs provide transparency and accurately reflect the activities of the wholesale distributor. FDA also believes that reliability of the records is contingent on having processes and procedures in place that restrict access to protect the integrity of the data. To this end, FDA is proposing to require in Section 205.27C that wholesale distributors implement written policies and procedures to protect the integrity of their records. Under proposed Section 205.27D, all records would be retained for a period of 3 years, except records related to suspect and illegitimate products, prescription drug quality complaints, and destroyed, returned, and recalled prescription drugs, which would need to be retained for a period of 6 years. Such record retention is necessary to ensure compliance and consistent enforcement of the various record-keeping requirements of the DSCSA. Proposed Section 205.28 provides for mandatory initial and periodic inspections of WDDs to ensure compliance with the national standards as required by DSCSA. As described in proposed Section 205.28 for inspections, at initial licensure, the facility to be used in wholesale distribution must undergo a physical inspection prior to the issuance of the WDD's license. FDA believes that it is imperative for the mandatory physical inspection to take place prior to issuing an initial license to a WDD to ensure that only those WDDs who have the ability to properly store, handle, and distribute prescription drugs in accordance with the national standards are licensed. Where the state is the licensing authority, the state in which the facility is located may conduct the inspection or may accept an inspection by a third-party accreditation or inspection service approved by the state licensing DWDD. If the facility is out of state, the state issuing the license may conduct the inspection or may accept an inspection by the state in which the facility is located or by a third party. Where the FDA is a licensing authority, the FDA may conduct the inspection or may accept an inspection conducted by an organization approved by FDA as described in proposed section 205.32. Under the proposed regulations, WDDs are expected to cooperate with the state or federal licensing authority or the approved organization conducting the inspection at reasonable times, within reasonable limits, and in a reasonable manner to achieve the objective of the inspection. WDDs will also be required to undergo a routine inspection once every 3 years. FDA believes routine inspections are an essential tool to ensure that the wholesale distributors continue to comply with the national standards after obtaining their initial wholesale distributor license and move to renew that license. Such routine inspections will be conducted by the licensing authority or third-party approved organization or inspection service approved by the FDA or the state licensing the WDD. Proposed Section 205.28B specifically addresses the availability of records. To facilitate the licensing authority's ability to complete the inspection, records kept at the inspection site or that can be immediately retrieved electronically must be made readily available during the inspection. For records kept at a central location apart from the inspection site and not electronically retrievable, such records must be made available for inspection within 2 business days of a request by a state or federal official, or sooner if necessitated by the duration of the inspection. Proposed Section 205.29 covers the requirements for initial and annual reporting to FDA. Under DSCSA, WDDs must report certain information to FDA to be considered an authorized trading partner. The annual reporting requirements for wholesale distributors went into effect on January 1, 2015. Proposed Section 205.29 clarifies the statutorily prescribed annual reporting requirements. FDA is proposing to require that WDDs use an electronic system provided by FDA to increase efficiency by providing uniformity in the content and format of reports, thereby making the information easier to process. Reporting information for each WDD in FDA's electronic system during the reporting period is integral to FDA's ability to provide oversight, as WDDs are prohibited from distributing product without a license. In accordance with reporting requirements for WDDs set forth in DSCSA, proposed Section 205.29C requires a WDD to electronically report to FDA the state by which the WDD is licensed and the corresponding license number. FDA is also proposing to require WDDs report the date each license expires. FDA believes this information is paramount to FDA's ability to establish and maintain a public database identifying each authorized wholesale distributor as required by Section 503E2B of the FD&C Act. If a WDD's license expires, it is no longer an authorized trading partner, and FDA will remove it from the public database until the license is renewed or a new license is issued. In addition, all trade names or business names and significant disciplinary actions taken against a WDD license would be reported. A WDD's initial report must be submitted within 30 calendar days of obtaining its initial license. Annual reporting must be completed each year between January 1st and March 31st. In addition to providing required reporting information upon initial licensure and annually, it is important for other trading partners and FDA to know whether a WDD has had a license revoked or suspended, or whether the WDD has had any other significant disciplinary action taken against them that limits the ability of a facility to conduct drug-related business. As such, the proposed rule includes Section 205.29D and E, where WDDs must report significant disciplinary actions as defined in proposed Section 205.3L to FDA. Significant disciplinary actions must be submitted at licensure, and for subsequent significant disciplinary actions within 30 calendar days of a final action taken by a state or federal licensing authority. A WDD will also be expected to report to FDA within 30 calendar days that it ceased operations as a WDD or voluntarily withdrawn a wholesale distributor's license from a state. FDA believes that requiring a wholesale distributor to report this information about the status of its license is essential for FDA to comply with the requirements under Section 503E2B of the FDNC Act and to ensure that the database is accurate and helpful for the states and training partners. Proposed Section 205.30 outlines the standards and processes for WDD license denials, suspensions, reinstatement, revocation, and voluntary termination. Proposed Section 205.30A1 describes 10 circumstances under which the licensing authority would be required to deny a WDD's request for licensure or license renewal. These circumstances are summarized on the slide and include, for example, inadequate facilities and controls to facilitate safe operations, failure to meet or comply with requirements for good storage practices, and failure to provide adequate opportunity for inspections of facilities, controls, or applicable records. FDA believes that this list will help WDDs focus on good storage practices outlined by FDA that are necessary to protect the integrity of the products in the pharmaceutical distribution supply chain. To avoid denial or delays of their applications, WDDs should ensure that they address the reasons for denial of a license outlined in proposed Section 205.30A1 when they file for licensure. Under proposed Section 205.30B and C, the suspension of a WDD's license may be initiated by the licensing authority upon reasonable belief that the licensee has failed to comply with any of the standards for receiving and maintaining licensure. The proposed standards for suspending a WDD license are based on the risk posed to public health. For example, if the licensing authority has a reasonable belief that the WDD is not in compliance with licensure requirements, and such noncompliance threatens the quality of the product or threatens public safety, the licensing authority is required to notify the WDD in writing of the intent to suspend its license and provide the WDD notice of opportunity for a hearing before suspending its license. However, if the WDD's noncompliance poses an imminent threat to public safety, such as a WDD continuing to ship illegitimate product after being made aware of the product's illegitimate status, the agency may suspend the license immediately while giving the WDD an opportunity to request a hearing after a license is suspended. Under proposed Section 205.30D, a WDD suspended license may be reinstated if the WDD can demonstrate to the licensing authority that it is in compliance with regulation requirements. The standards for revoking a WDD license are set forth in proposed Section 205.30E. The licensing authority will revoke a license if it finds that a WDD whose license has been suspended or is unable or refuses to comply with the licensing requirements. In addition to describing the circumstances under which a license may be denied, suspended, or revoked, proposed Section 205.30 outlines the processes for these actions. In general, the procedures for the denial of an application for licensure and for the suspension or revocation of a license involve written notice by the licensing authority, an opportunity for the WDD to respond, and the opportunity for a WDD to request a hearing. As previously mentioned, however, where there is an imminent threat to public safety, the agency may suspend a license immediately without an opportunity to respond to the suspension notice. In this scenario, the WDD is given opportunity to request a hearing after the license is suspended. Under the proposed rule, the procedures in 21 CFR parts 10 through 16 apply with respect to hearings and appeals of denied, suspended, or revoked WDD licenses. FDA believes that this proposed approach is consistent with current practice and suggests that states develop comparable processes. Proposed Section 205.30 also sets forth conditions for licensure non-renewals and voluntary terminations. Where a WDD fails to submit an application for renewal by the date of the license's expiration, the license will be considered expired. The WDD may not engage in wholesale distribution with an expired license and must submit a new application for licensure. A WDD requesting that the licensing authority terminates its license must include in its request a notice of the WDD's intent to discontinue prescription drug wholesale distribution and waiver of an opportunity for a hearing. The WDD will be required to apply for a new license should it decide to resume wholesale distribution. Proposed Section 205.31, 205.32, and 205.33 cover the process for the use of approved third-party organizations, general qualification, and approval by FDA, respectively. However, like AOs for 3PLs, we will not be covering approved organizations for WDDs in this presentation. We will follow up in the future with more information on approved organizations as we move forward in the implementation process. This concludes our review of the proposed regulations for national standards for licensure of wholesale distributor and third-party logistics providers. I now turn it over back to Aaron.
All right. Thank you very much, Sarah. Please see our webpage for a link to the proposed rule and instructions for how to submit comments to the public docket on the proposal. On this slide, we're also providing some other FDA resources for you where you can find the latest updates regarding the DSCSA implementation, as well as other useful information, including DSCSA regulatory documents, such as relevant FDA guidances and regulations, public meetings, and webinars. In conclusion, I'd like to thank you all for your attention and for watching this webinar outlining the national standards for licensure for wholesale drug distributors and third-party logistics providers. We hope you found it informative. We'd like to remind you that you can submit comments on the proposed regulation at regulations.gov by June 6, 2022, to allow for FDA to consider your comments. Specific thank yous to Elizabeth Popinski and Sarah Kim Keller for joining me by presenting at this webinar. Thank you to Ray and the staff at SBIA and my colleagues from CDER's Office of Compliance and across the agency for making this webinar possible.